I go to the gym every other day during the week and sometimes on Saturdays. It's just weight training and then cardio.
We walk at least, I would say at least 2 to 3 miles a day, like kind of in the morning and then in the evening.
I walk at least 15 minutes a day, and I work out at the gym on Saturdays about 45 minutes to an hour.
When I'm home, not traveling, I just try to run like 2 or 3 times a week, about a mile total, like around my neighborhood.
I do some exercises at home for about 20 minutes, and then I walk about 45 minutes to an hour every day.
Swimming is my main sport, and I go regularly once a week.
Going out riding a bike, sitting on the couch drinking beers doesn't work, so I just gotta go out and it's like take a nice long ride.
Fitness has always been a priority for me. I ran track, I was a dancer. So I like being physically fit. I like sweating.
My favorite tool to work out is kettlebells. I think that they're very a great way to use cardio and resistance training in a few exercises. So the swing, the squat, the overhead press, combined with body weight exercises are a good way to get a total body workout.
Let's box it out.
Hi, I'm Anqoinette Crosby. Are you feeling fit and fabulous for summer? Well, if you're not, you'll definitely want to check out our next show. Get the latest and greatest workout and wellness tips coming up right now on Vocal Point. Welcome to Vocal Point. On today's show, we're getting you in shape on the inside and out. Our experts are going to give us useful tips for our physical body and physical space as well. You'll see how the two go hand in hand. My guests are here and ready to offer great ideas on how to make that happen. Tristan Kier is an interior designer. He owns the Tristan Company, a commercial and residential design firm. He's going to show us ways to make our living space a little more peaceful and organized. Danielle Douglas Gabrielle is a fitness and finance writer for the Washington Post. She's also a certified trainer. She'll give us the latest on streaming exercise programs, fitness apps, and more. Dr. Scott Kahan is the director of the Center for Weight and Wellness. He's board certified in obesity medicine and clinical nutrition. He was also an advisor for First Lady Michelle Obama's Let's Move program to combat childhood obesity. He's a trainer and has been rated one of the area's top docs in preventative medicine. And we have fitness expert and trainer Gerard Burley, better known as Coach G. He owns Coach G Fitness and is dedicated to getting people healthy and staying fit. Thanks to all of you for being here. Coach G, we're going to start with you. So I was at your studio and you showed me some great exercises mm-hmm. that should whip us into shape. Let's take a look. Coach G, show us some of the latest fitness moves.
All right, so one of the latest and greatest fitness exercises and fitness piece of equipment that's out there is a TRX band. So a lot of people have seen this, but a lot of people don't know how many different things you can do with it.
Okay.
When we're thinking about the TRX, one of the cool things about it is lightweight, it uses your body weight, and it doesn't take up a lot of space. You can do it in your home, you can do it in your office, you can do it at the gym, whatever. So one of my favorite ones here, we're gonna start all the way back. We're gonna work on our backs and those arms that everyone wants to,
absolutely.
That everyone wants those Michelle Obama arms.
Oh yeah, let's go.
I'm gonna show you how to get it.
Okay, let's do it.
So we're here, we're gonna get our feet a little bit forward, we're gonna get on our heels, keeping our body in alignment, keep the shoulder in line with the hips, in line with the knees, in line with the ankles. We're gonna open up a little bit, and pull our chest right up to our hands, okay? Coming back, and up. And as you feel this, You feel like you're using a lot of your back muscles, using your arm. But you also are using a lot of your core muscles. So everyone's trying to get that midsection right. Whether it's summer or winter, it's never the wrong season to have the right midsection, right? So we're gonna work with the medicine ball a little bit. We're gonna start off with the V-sit twist, or some people call them Russian twists. So we're gonna get our legs about 90 degree angle, shoulders up. We're gonna twist to one side, lightly touch the ground with the ball, and then bring it back to the other side, lightly touch. And this is one that looks like it's not hurting a lot.
Oh, but I'll tell you, it is.
Exactly. So we're twisting over side to side, and you're just gonna try to get as many as you can until your legs really feel like, oh, okay, I'm about done. Mm-hmm. You just start about 10 and then ease up until you get to about 20. So another one of my really, really like high intensity interval training type exercises that I like to work with are my bad ropes. So this is great because it's gonna help tone your arms, which is great. Work your back and shoulders, but also get your heart rate up. Right. So you're gonna burn a lot of calories while you're doing this in a short amount of time. All right, so we're gonna do this. Let's do 10 seconds straight, hard as we can. All right, okay. One at a time. Ready? Set, go. 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right. Woo!
Okay, you tried to hurt me. It was fun though, it was really fun. So what makes your personal training approach so unique?
Yeah, I think the thing that makes my training whole outlook a lot different than most trainers is I focus on the mental aspect. So many times we're focusing on what exercise to do, counting calories, figuring out what's the latest craze of exercise, when in actuality, if you're not getting your mind right, there's no way you're gonna get your body tight.
Okay, so why is it important for people to incorporate weight training into their workouts?
Well, when you think about weight training, a lot of times that's gonna help you to raise your metabolism, that's gonna help you to be stable, keep your core tight. In a lot of ways, it's gonna help not only give you the body you want, but it's gonna help prevent some injuries that might happen later on. So you gotta incorporate some type of resistance and weight training and not just do cardio stuff.
So what are some of the latest workouts that you've seen?
Oh my God, how much time we got?
Not too much time. Yeah.
No, I would say one thing that like we showed earlier, the TRX band is a great little device that you can take wherever. You can hook it up to a door. Mm-hmm. You can see it in any gym right now. A lot of people still don't know exactly how to use it, but it's a great exercise because it's based off body weight and not based off the equipment or the big heavy equipment, machines that we see all the time. So you can use it pretty much anywhere and help your whole body.
So is that yet another piece of equipment that we have to buy?
Yet another one, yeah. Yes. I guess so. One thing I tell people that your best piece of equipment is this right here.
Mm-hmm.
So I always start with your body weight and then build from that to a different point. So you don't have to spend that $5,000 on a treadmill, because that treadmill today is probably gonna be a coat hanger next year if you don't.
Yeah,
really work
that, ain't that the truth? And TRX is $200, right?
About $200. You can find it online, probably, some sales may around $150. But the great thing is, it's a total body exercise, and TRX doesn't pay me, but just saying, it's one that I recommend because it works. Okay. You can do everything on it.
Speaking of what works, Danielle, you wrote a story for the Washington Post recently about the latest, greatest workout trends for 2015, and technology is playing a big role in people's workouts. Talk about some of the latest technology gadgets.
So everyone loves their phone, their smartphone, and there are so many things that you can do on that, as well as your computer. There are a lot of apps that you can download for free often, or sometimes for a low cost. One of my favorite apps is the Nike Training Club, and they also don't pay me, but I do swear by it. And what's nice, a lot of Nike stores in major cities across the country sometimes offer free classes. So if you want to take that fitness from your phone straight into an actual studio and be with others, you can do that. They often have live DJs. It's an hour-long boot camp. But what's great about that particular app is that there are video instructions that'll show you exactly how to do each move, so that you never have to worry about hurting yourself and not having the proper alignment. There are also a lot of really great streaming sites. Mm-hmm. There's Booyah Fitness, Crunch Live. A lot of these sites kind of replace the DVDs and videos that a lot of people used to use. What's great about these sites is that they keep giving you new workouts. Mm-hmm. So every month you'll get a couple of different options, and you can choose from which one works best for you. And what's great about this is that you can, if you're traveling a lot for work, this is a good way to make sure that you're not slacking on your fitness routine if you're not able to get to the gym, or if you don't feel like running around a city that you're not too familiar with. A lot of these streaming sites are anywhere from about $8.50 a month to $12 a month, which is a lot cheaper than a gym membership. Not that I advocate not going to the gym. I'm also an instructor, so please go to the gym. But there are lots of great things that you can do.
Okay, so you brought up a good point about being able to work out when you're on vacation. So let's say you don't get an app. What are some other things that you can do in your hotel room or even at work if you just don't find the time to work out after you get home?
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say it's probably one of the biggest questions I get from people. But I think you gotta take a step back, and your success on the road really starts before you even leave. Mm-hmm. Because when you're on the road, you have so many activities, whether it's for work or for vacation, you're focused on so many other activities besides your workout. You gotta really write that into your schedule. So I always tell my clients before you leave, put your workout into your schedule, your Google Calendar, your Microsoft Outlook, or whatever else app you use to keep your life organized, get that situated. And then there are a lot of things you can do, just body weight exercises like planks or push-ups or lunges or squats, that are just as effective, if not more effective, than a lot of the big machines you see in the gym.
And you're gonna show us an example on how to do a plank correctly a little bit later in the show. Scott, we're gonna bring you in. How much exercise do we really need to get per day, or physical activity per day?
So a good general recommendation is about 30 minutes of moderate intensity physical activity daily. That's great, but everything counts. So if you can do that, that's wonderful. If you can be in the gym doing strength training and all of that, that's of course wonderful. But even if you can't, any little bit of physical activity that you can add on is valuable. So if you're not doing anything right now, just going for a little bit of walks, even for a few minutes, is a really great step. And if you're exercising a little bit, even just taking a little bit more from that, a few more minutes a day, one more day a week, even if you're not at that 30 minutes yet, that's gonna be very valuable.
What are the consequences if we don't? If we just remain couch potatoes, if we remain a country that continues to get fatter and fatter, what are the consequences?
Well, you know, I'm working on a research study right now with some doctors at Harvard, and we have found so far 154 different diseases that are associated with obesity. So there are the things that we've heard of, like diabetes and high cholesterol, and also a whole lot of other things like sleep apnea and neurologic problems and osteoarthritis and so forth. So there's all sorts of these health problems that are a result of inactivity and increased body weight and unhealthy nutrition, and that's why it's really important that we focus on these.
So what about eating right? You know, how much does that play a role in our overall health?
It's essential. Along with physical activity, those are the two healthiest things that we can do to make sure that we prevent disease down the line, to have lots of energy, to feel good, to not be limited, to be able to do all the things that we want to do.
So do they go hand in hand, exercise and eating? Is there one that's a little bit more important than the other? Or?
They're both important, and for different people, they're of different importance. So some people, for example, are able to be pretty active and have a harder time with nutrition, and that's something that we can focus on more, is the nutrition. For other people, they do very well with nutrition, but they have a hard time getting physical activity into their life, and they may want to work with coach. So they're both very important, but for each person, we focus on different areas.
So, you know, we've all tried diets, let's be real, and I was doing paleo, which I don't think is more a diet, but just kind of a lifestyle change for me in the way I was eating. What do you think of paleo and the Mediterranean diet and the South Beach diet? How are those for folks?
So we've actually done a number of studies on those, looking at comparing the different diets together. And there's a couple of key points that we found out. The first one is, on average, all diets lead to the exact same amount of weight loss. But there's two really important caveats there. The first one is that nobody here is average. You're your own person, I'm my own person, and so forth. And so different people respond better to one diet versus the next. If you like the paleo lifestyle, if you like those types of foods, that's a perfectly reasonable way of moving forward. If you like the Mediterranean type diet, that's a great way of managing your diet as well. So I wouldn't be restricted to any one or another, and I wouldn't listen to claims that say that this diet is the best diet or that diet is the best. Personal preference goes a long way in this, and as long as you have something that you're following that's reasonable, that can lead to a lot of success.
Okay, and so Coach G, do you tailor
the training for each person that comes in? I'm sure you do.
Yeah.
Training techniques.
I mean, the biggest thing with like personal training is there's not a cookie cutter approach. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of trainers take that approach where they're 9 o'clock clients doing the same thing at 10 o'clock. You walk in and didn't she just do that? What's she trying to do? Same thing I'm trying to do? You know, like, no. So you have to look at each person individually. And I think, you know, Dr. Scott really touched on something where like, the best diet is the one you can stick with.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not going to tell you, you got to eat this, you got to eat this, you got to eat this. What does that matter if you're only going to do it for a week and then go eat cookies behind my back and not let me know? You know, the thing is, can you stay consistent and really get in that mindset where this is a marathon, not a sprint. It's mm-hmm. a lifestyle change that we're trying to do. And the quicker you can adapt to that, I think the quicker you'll see your success.
How important are classes for yoga and Pilates and even meditation? How does that play a role in fitness?
Yeah, again, I think it goes to what you like. Like, some people, if you're in yoga class and you're thinking about, you know, what movie you're gonna watch tomorrow, then that Zen's not really hitting you, you know? But if, so that might not be where you need to be. Mm-hmm. But if you're in a class that's high intensity and boot camp and you're like, I am not high intensity, I need to be, you know, chilling out, getting my namaste on, then you maybe need to find that. So I really encourage people, you know, a lot of people come to me and they're like, you know, why is your stuff the best? Why should I do this? And I'll say, you know what, try me out. See if you like it. If you don't, it's not a personal thing. I want you to find what's best for you, because in the grand scheme of things, I'm here to help everyone become healthier. So that's okay. What it is.
Scott, is it ever too late to get started? What about fitness for the elderly?
It's never too late to get started. There's also a lot of studies on fitness in aging populations, in elderly populations, in populations that have disabilities. Any type of movement within what you're able to do is going to be valuable.
What about those with limited mobility? Are there exercises that you can offer to those folks?
Yeah, I really live by the motto that let pain be your guide.
Mm-hmm.
So if it hurts, don't do it.
Oh, so it's not no pain, no gain?
I really don't think it shouldn't hurt. Slight discomfort, I'm okay with.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, but it shouldn't be painful.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, maybe you know, you work a little bit outside your comfort zone, a little bit outside your comfort zone, and then along that line, you know, after a month or two, you'll see some changes where what's a little bit outside your comfort zone now is leaps and bounds from where you began.
Okay. Danielle, what are some good exercises you can do sitting in the office?
Well, one thing I try to do is check my posture. Mm-hmm. A lot of it, I realize. Oh. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, everybody's just so that you're engaging your core. I think mm-hmm. a lot of great exercises are based upon how strong your core is, and making sure that you're constantly engaged in that makes it easier. If you're trying a Pilates class, or if you're trying yoga or some of the other things, there are a few foundational exercises that I love. I don't necessarily know if you could do them at your desk, mm-hmm. but squats are a fantastic exercise mm-hmm. for everyone. Push-ups. I teach classes that have a lot of women in them, and they tend not to feel comfortable doing a lot of upper body exercises, but they're so fantastic for many of the reasons that the doctor said, mainly because you never know if later in life, if you were going to fall or anything, you'd want to make sure that you're able to lift yourself and you have that kind of strength.
Okay. Coach G, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I definitely would piggyback on the core. I say the mm-hmm. core is the foundation of your house,
mm-hmm.
so I just kind of start there, because every motion that we do in life starts from the core.
Okay, so what do you mean by that? So we're sitting here, is there something that we could be doing?
Yeah, so one thing that I tell people to do like throughout the day, even you can do at the desk, is something called abdominal bracing. So
yeah.
The way I describe it is, we've all been to the beach, and you gotta tuck it in, mm-hmm. it's gotta be right, it's gotta be tight, but you still gotta be able to breathe and say, hey. That's abdominal bracing. So that's the first thing you wanna do, whether we're walking around, whether you're at the office, whether you're doing any core activity or doing something in the gym. And that right there is actually engaging your core and all of the abdominal muscles that we have wrapping around from here to here.
Okay. Scott?
You know, don't forget about walking.
Mm-hmm.
So I think these are great exercises, but one of the things that I try to do during busy days when I don't have time to go to the gym and I don't have time to exercise is just try to sneak even a 5-minute walk in during my day, walk around the block, come back. I feel better in my head, and it's also good for my body.
Okay. Even if you have steps at home, you know, running up and down, or walking up and down the steps, I guess, could make a difference.
right?
Definitely.
Okay. So let's talk about children. You have parents out there that are, you know, struggling to get their kids to eat healthier and be active. What suggestions do you have for those parents?
Yeah, so first is to set the stage for healthy behaviors. So if you want your kids to eat fruits and vegetables, you have to have fruits and vegetables in the house. Mm-hmm. And ideally, if they're cut up nice and front and center in the refrigerator, they're more likely to go and grab those. On the other hand, if you have the fruits and vegetables, but right on top of it is a whole bunch of cookies or cake, they're more likely to get those. So as much as possible, setting the stage for healthy behaviors is really important. Second thing is modeling healthy behaviors. Mm-hmm. So if you're telling your kids to eat broccoli and you're eating chips and fries, that's going to be a hard sell. So you want to model the healthy behaviors for your kids. And then the third thing is to appeal to their autonomy. We want kids to want to be healthy. Mm-hmm. So how do you make a kid want to do healthy behaviors? Well, the first thing is make it fun. Mm-hmm. So if I have a 4.5-year-old kid, Cole, if I tell him to go running a mile, he's gonna look at me like I'm crazy. But if we go out and play some soccer together or something like that, that's fun. It's not mm-hmm. exercise, it's fun. And that's something he's gonna wanna do. So I think those are the things that I would really try to focus on.
Okay, those are all great tips. All right, we're going to put you to work now.
All right,
yeah,
let's do it.
Yeah, so you're going to demo the correct way to do a plank.
I'm going to actually have Danielle help me out here. Yes. All right, so we'll stand up. So the plank, I love the plank. It's a great starting exercise for any core base because mm-hmm. gravity is going to push you, is going to be the thing that's pushing you down, but it's no actual motion, so it's a great way to start off. So I'm going to have Danielle start on her forearms and her toes. So I'm gonna show the first way. So this is like a normal plank position. We wanna make sure she, her spine is in alignment, her glutes are squeezed, her core is brought in like we talked about before.
Right.
And really this is it, you just try not to fall down.
That's it.
That's it. And you know, key things you wanna look at here is like, when your hips start to drop a little bit, you're getting fatigued, go ahead and go down to the ground, right? So another little variation of this, because this might be pretty tough if people are just starting out, is go down to your knees, Danielle, for me, please, and bring your hips up just a little bit, right, move it right there, okay? So this is a variation that you can go to that's still going to engage your core a lot, but the thing is you want to really look for, the shoulder is in line right over top of the elbow, so everything is in alignment, and the back is nice and flat, parallel to the ground, and you can work your way up to the other one.
And length of time.
I mean, your body will tell you, honestly.
Yeah.
Everyone's body is different. You know, how much weight you have, what you've been through that day, it really matters, what you've been eating.
Okay.
So, you know, maybe start off with 10 seconds, just see how it feels. And when you start shaking, come down and do it again.
And how many sets?
I would say 3 sets.
Oh, okay.
3 sets. And then each week, maybe adding in about 10 seconds.
All right.
You can rest.
Good job. Thank you. Thanks. So, is that what you do in the boot camp class that you
teach?
That
is one of the things I do. I love variations of push-ups, like power push-ups, the one where you jump out and come in.
Yeah.
Lots of plyometric exercises, jump squats, burpees, all those things. What's nice about those exercises is that if you don't have a lot of time and you're trying to get in a lot with your exercise, 20 minutes, a couple of rounds, 5 of those exercises, and you're good.
All right, sounds great. Dr. Shayla Cornick owns Cycle Studios in downtown Silver Spring, Maryland. Now, I visited her at her studio where I learned some basic spin techniques. She came to the studio today with her team, Jennifer and Ryan, to give us a quick demonstration.
At Cycled, you're gonna get a full body workout with high intensity cardio and low impact on your knees. Are you all ready to ride?
Let's go.
All right, let's do it. Let's push that gear to a 10 for me. RPMs, let's go to 110, come on. We're gonna start with push-ups and our elbows down for 8. Down and up, down, up. Good job. Down, up, down, up, down, up. Get ready to double time, come on. Down, 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 down. Your gear to a 12 for me. Get ready to come out the saddle. bring it up. Slow it down a little bit.
Back with the bass. Pajamas live in effect and I don't waste time.
How we doing? With a dope rhyme. Jump to the Let's rhythm. Go with our elbows back. Right. And I'm here. Left. Right.
Thank you to Shayla. Okay, well, we're going to continue the discussion. So, spin. Do you guys do it or believe in it?
I'm a big fan of spin or cycling, indoor cycling. Spin is a certain type of cycling. But I recommend it to a lot of people who I first start off with because it's not a lot of impact. And a lot of the boot camp classes or a lot of the insanity, those type of classes, involve a lot of impact. And if you have joint issues, this is a great way to get a good high intensity cardio exercise and save your joints. Especially as you get older, I mean, you gotta watch how much impact we're putting on those joints.
Okay. Scott, how about you?
I think spinning is a great exercise. I prefer being outside more. So for me, going for a walk outside is my most fun exercise. I really enjoy that.
Okay.
I do enjoy cycling. It's not my, I do love the high intensity stuff, but it is a great way, especially if someone's just getting back into fitness. Great low impact. It's really fantastic for folks who have joint issues, as you mentioned before. So I highly recommend it.
Now, Scott, you had introduced to medical schools some of the first courses in nutrition, and that's very interesting to me because this is all very recent. So what took so long for that to happen?
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting. Doctors don't learn about nutrition and physical activity or obesity and weight gain. When I was in medical school, we had one single lecture in 4 years that was focused on obesity and nutrition and physical activity. It was about a half hour long, and it basically said people need to eat less and exercise more. We all know that, but that's not helpful to patients. So. What we tried to do is build some courses that would help teach medical students and residents how to counsel and support their patients in changing their physical activity and changing their nutrition and building healthy lives. And it's been very, very well received.
I'm sure it has been. Well, it's been said that mess causes stress. Ain't that the truth? When we return, we're going to discuss with Tristan how organizing and beautifying your physical space can help your mind, body, and spirit. But first, take a look at a new fitness craze called Pound. It was started by two female drummers from California. Now, we found classes at Crunch Fitness gyms right here in DC. Take a look.
Pound is a total body workout. It is a combination of cardio, Pilates, isometric movements, plyometric poses, and isometric poses combined into a 45-minute total body workout with very loud music to which you drum the entire time. There's no cheating in Pound. You're gonna push yourself to be out there and do it right on the beat. You don't wanna be the one person in class drumming out, you know, out of beat. We have specific songs for glutes and we have specific songs where we go down on the mat for abs. But again, we're drumming. We're not just doing crunches. So time flies by and before you know it, you're done.
Well, that's a fun way to burn calories. And Tristan, you should know because congrats to you. You recently lost 100 pounds. So you got to tell us how you did that.
Oh my goodness, I starved myself.
Don't let the doctor hear
you. No. You know what? This is my second time around in weight loss. I lost 61 pounds in 3 months in 2013 spinning. And I've lost 100 pounds, basically a combination of spin, trail biking, working out with this guy over here because he's my partner in crime, Coach G, coming into Sweat Fitness, going to his spin class, but also changing my entire diet. And I'm more or less on a very high protein diet. I am slowly becoming a vegan because I suffer from diverticulitis, ulcerative colitis, because I was almost 400 pounds and surpassed 400 pounds at one point. So I've got some medical issues with my digestive system, so I've had to change my eating habits and totally go to protein and more plant-based food. So that's been the journey. The journey still continues because we've got some more weight to get off this, you know, body, but I feel good and it's an ongoing thing.
Did your doctor warn you that you needed to do something and something very quickly?
Absolutely. I've had 3 colonoscopies in a 5-year period. Along with that, my last gastroenterologist who diagnosed me said, you are either going to die or you're going to lose this weight. And this illness, diverticulitis ulcerative colitis, is a really aggressive illness that attacks the digestive tract and limits the amount of things that I can eat. You know, foods with seeds in it, a lot of foods that have gluten in it. So it was an ultimatum that my gastroenterologist gave me, and death wasn't an option for me. So I had to wake up one morning and say, it's time to live and it's time to lose this weight.
So you did it the natural way. You didn't go through surgery, gastric, or anything?
Well, you know, it's interesting because Coach G and I talked about it, and I wasn't actually going to have this conversation on camera.
Oh.
But I saved it. I actually did have gastric bypass surgery. I had gastric bypass surgery 2 months ago.
Wow.
But I started losing this weight before then. You know, when you go through the gastric bypass procedure, mm-hmm. There you have to go through a behavioral modification period, and mine was 3 months, so I lost 60 pounds
on my own,
and the rest has come off. So I'm not like most gastric patients because I'm 6'5", so you have some that are 5'5", and are 400 pounds. My weight is coming off very naturally, so I won't have that emaciated look, hopefully. but it's been a journey. It's funny because Coach G texted me the other day, and he said, are you gonna talk about it? So this is the first time I've ever talked about it.
He asked me would I talk about it,
and I said, no one knows. So this is the first time I've ever actually admitted it in the 3 months that I'm post-surgery.
Well, you look fantastic.
Thank you.
Now, Scott, I know you see patients that are in his same situation. Talk about those options. Do you think more people should opt for surgery?
Yeah, so I want to be really clear on this. So first of all, it's important to separate prevention and treatment. So we should all be working on eating healthy and being physically active and preventing weight-related and nutrition-related health problems down the line. But when it happens that weight keeps going up and health keeps getting poorer and you keep trying harder and harder and harder to lose weight and you're not able to do it, it's really important to have treatments that can help. And that can include surgery, it can include medications, it can include medically monitored programs. And I don't think that we should be making excuses for those. Those are important treatments mm-hmm. that are valuable. They shouldn't be used as a first line for anybody. But just like Tristan, he's been dieting over and over and over again, and he was able to find a tool that was really helpful for him and look at all of his progress. So unfortunately, these treatments are very minimally used. Only about 1% of people who are candidates for bariatric surgery get bariatric surgery. Right. Only about 1.5% of people who are candidates for obesity medications use obesity medications. Mm-hmm. And certainly, I don't think 100% of them are good candidates, but I think a lot more would get value for them in situations where they can't do it with diet and exercise alone.
So why are so few getting the surgery and using medications?
There's a number of reasons. First of all, there's very poor insurance coverage, mm-hmm. So many people don't have access to them. Second of all, there's very poor understanding of what these medications are and what these surgeries are. So a lot of times, patients don't understand what it's really all about, and they're not necessarily open to it as an option. A lot of times, doctors don't really know what it's mm-hmm. all about because they don't get training in this, and they often close that avenue to patients. So that's another big reason. There's others, but those are two of the big ones.
And surgery and meds aren't the be-all, end-all. You still have to continue working
Absolutely.
Out, right?
It's hard, you know, but it's a workout every day.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So when you were at your highest weight, did you get depressed? And what did you do? Did you, because I know you're an interior designer, mm-hmm. so what other things did you need to do in order to motivate you?
You know what, my home looked like my physical. Mm. So I was this very large man, and my home wasn't that large, but it was filled with stuff mm-hmm. because I was depressed, I was stressed. I found that taking out all of the clutter and organizing my home attributed to my wellness and my health. I would say to tell anyone who's going, you know, through a weight loss journey right now that, you know, Gerard and I say this all the time, if your interior doesn't look well, your exterior won't look well. And so I would say focus on your interior and your exterior at the same time in order to give yourself the best physical benefit of having a healthy lifestyle, but also having a healthy living environment.
So how do you get out of the rut? How do you do that? You wake up every day and you see everything that's already placed. What motivates you to say, okay, I'm going to make a change? How can you give us some tips to do that?
You know what? It's amazing because when I come home every day, you know, I deal with the stressors of life, but I leave all of that at the door and I walk into this beautifully designed home designed by me. And it is my retreat. It's my escape from the outside world. It is a sanctuary that is clean. It's well organized. Actually, these are some pieces that have come from my home. Okay. I think that you really need to infuse your environment with beautiful things that you can look at. I love great artwork. I bought this picture in to show everyone. This is a picture of Venice. This is a dream to go to Venice and take a gondola ride. Put that in your home. You know, your home has to be so aesthetically beautiful so that it can match the new aesthetically beautiful person that you've become.
That's a great
point. So that's what that's the journey that I'm on, and I would tell anyone, put that in your home as well.
What tips can you give us to do it on a budget?
On a budget.
Yeah.
So, that's not my favorite word.
I know, not mine either, but
you know what?
Reality.
You know, the one thing that is so essential, I think that when you walk into someone's home, the smell should always be incredible. You can go to places like Home Goods, you can go to Apothecary, you can go to Bloomingdale's, I mean, whatever your price point is, but particularly on a budget, Home Goods is the best place to buy the greatest candles. I love anything that's fragrant with Moroccan tobacco or jasmine. I love beautiful accessories, vases, and things like this. That's what really, really makes you make it, I guess you could say, aesthetically pleasing and fun. But Home Goods, TJ Maxx, Marshalls, you can find things at the thrift store. You've got to accentuate the home with things that personify you and make you happy.
Okay, so give us a few things for women and then a few things for men.
So I think, you know, I find that women love pillows. I find that women love throws. I find that women love luxury sofas. Because they like to read. I would recommend a tufted sofa for you. The Kendall sofa at World Market is really beautiful.
Write that down.
You know what, for men, scents are incredible because a lot of brothers are single and they're trying to set the mood. I always tell men that good bedding is important. You know, not because you're trying to, you know, to necessarily sleep in it, but you got to impress in it as well.
Yeah.
You know, and so you want to make sure you have a beautiful, you know, exactly. So you want to be able to have a beautifully decorated bed. And men don't like to have great bedspreads and linen and all that. Believe me, it'll make a difference in your love life. And the other thing for men, you know, I'm just being very honest. And the other thing for men, the biggest thing, we're seeing a lot of classic men. There's a song that's dedicated to it now. We're seeing more men buying valets, which are those little stands that you can put your pants on and your jacket and you have the drawer that comes out. That's amazing. It's something different. And organization, all in all, for men and women are so important.
So do we need to hire you?
Absolutely.
I walked into that.
I'm available today.
But if we can't, what tells us, okay, today we're going to start? How do you get up the next day and say, okay, I'm going to do this?
You know what? I think that you really have to look at your situation and you have to say, okay, what's important? What can we give away and what should we think about? You know, particularly when we talk about organization. And you have to say, do I want to live my very best life in this home or do I want to continue to look at this chaos and be unhappy? That's the first start. And then you really have to figure out, okay, what are the essentials that I need to live in my home and live well in my home? My home doesn't have a lot of stuff in it. Gerard's been to my home. You know, it's not a lot of things in there. It's just very simple accoutrements. You know, at high and low.
High and low end, yes.
You know,
explain high and low to folks that don't know.
So for those who high and low, so for example, I'm a thrift store shopper. I had a client who was throwing away these beautiful $1,300 Calico Corner chairs. Calico Corners is a store, a national retail chain that sells furniture. I told her, I said, don't throw them away. I'll bring them in my house. But I went out and I bought, you know, a $500 coffee table and I accentuated with, you know, $10 little figurines. You know, you really have to have a hodgepodge of things that are beautiful, but it's cost effective to your budget.
Okay. Scott, I want to bring you into this discussion. I mean, as a doctor, of course, you're focused on the body, but do you also talk to patients about what they need to do within their home? I mean, not just clear out their refrigerator, but, you know, their space. Is that important in your consultation with patients?
We spend a lot of time on both the body and the mind. We have PhD psychologists and dietitians and exercise physiologists and such in my office. But honestly, one of the things we don't necessarily talk about is the people's homes in terms of how they're designed like this. I think that's brilliant.
Yeah. It is brilliant. Danielle, as a woman, what do you think of what he's saying?
I'm making a mental checklist. You know this, right?
I'll give you my card out.
No, I mean, it's so true. It's funny. I just finished redecorating my apartment, right. And so much of it, just having everything organized, right. Makes me feel less chaotic. Mm-hmm. So I completely agree.
You would be surprised how color, lighting, and texture will change an environment very easily. Now, my walls are all white because I rent my apartment, mm-hmm. but I've complemented this space with textured pillows, with colorful throws, and things that really inspire me to create and just be happy and live a good life.
And like you said, you don't have to spend a lot.
No.
Right. Yeah. Okay. So you agree with that? You've been to this place.
No, it's funny how it translates. You know, we work together. We do so very different things, but a lot of the same things. Mm-hmm. When I see a client for the first time, so many times they're coming from a place mentally where they're not happy with themselves, mm-hmm. they're not happy with their body, and it's been going on for years and years and years. And what do they show up in? A black shirt and a black leotard with black socks and black shoes. just cover it all up. Mm-hmm. I said, no. Like, you're telling me, before you even do anything, before you open your mouth, you're telling me so much about what you're going through right there.
Yeah.
So we slowly try to peel off these layers. And, one thing you talked to Tristan about is, how do you make that change? Mm-hmm. For me, it's the whys and not the whats. Mm-hmm. So many times we're like, oh, I need to lose the weight. I need to do that. And what I ask, why do you want to do that? What are you going to get from that? I'm like, oh, I never thought about that. And then you start really getting to the core of that. So it's like, oh, when I lose weight, I will build confidence. I will feel better about mm-hmm. myself. I will love myself a little bit more. Mm-hmm. And when you start talking about those whys and you get to the base of it, then that motivation is there. Mm-hmm. But if you talk about the whats all the time, you're just looking at superficial stuff. So I try to I try to open people's minds. Right. Like, but what color you're wearing, like, it all interlays together, so. Okay.
Not so much about the new wardrobe I get, if I get down to a size.
Yeah, and not about the wardrobe, okay. But because if your body is tight, you can just wear a white t-shirt and be that.
All right.
All I got is white t-shirts.
Tristan, what are some of the hot design trends going on right now?
You know what, as we go into the fall, indigo is the color of the fall. Mm. We're seeing a lot of minimalist design, which is really cool because mm-hmm. I think that particularly for small spaces, you don't need to put a lot into it. Mustard is a fun color that is arriving this fall as well. We like those colors because they're vibrant and beautiful. We're seeing a mixture of lamps and spaces, tall floor lamps, table lamps, things of that nature. We're seeing a lot of people taking daring risks with colored sofas, which we love. It's colors and like sofas and aubergine and and emerald green and things of that nature. So those are some of the fun trends that we'll see coming this fall.
You mentioned having different decorations for each season, just
absolutely.
Like you do your wardrobe. Mm-hmm. So explain that a little bit.
I think the design has to change for the seasons. Like, my home is going through its summer East Hampton look. So everything is very neutral and white and clean mm-hmm. and nautical. But for the fall, it becomes a little heavier. We bring in earth tones. And as we move into the holiday season, we incorporate some, holiday decorations. And then spring comes and, we bring in the linen draperies and things of that nature. Mm-hmm. I think it has to change, particularly when you're talking about, holiday time. You've got to have a great decorative closet. Mm-hmm. I have a decorative closet in my home. That is not an expectation or requirement for everyone, but I think it's a necessity, particularly when we talk about organization. But I bring the decorations out, the wreaths and all the fun things. Not too much, we don't want it to be overkill.
Right.
But stuff that's really subtle and beautiful and just kind of gives a subtle hint of the season.
Okay, well, in just a moment, we're gonna ask our studio audience to join the conversation. But first, here's our social media question of the day. We tweeted, what's your best excuse for not exercising? Well, at High High Blackbird said, there's work, sleep, play, and errands. How to fit exercise in? At NewsGirl03 answered, time, time, time. Never enough of it. And at Breon Page added, as a grad student, it can be hard to balance fitness and my large amounts of homework.
Well, we want to make sure that we leave enough time for our studio audience to ask questions. And so when you're ready, step up to the mic, give us your name and affiliation, and briefly state your question or comments. Hello.
Hello, my name is Macrecia Watkins. I'm actually a grad student here at Howard. And my question is actually for you. I love pictures, and I come from a family of 10. So I have pictures all over my living room. So it probably looks cluttered. What's your suggestion?
I think there's nothing wrong with dedicating one wall in your house to a montage of photographs, but I think that you have to put the photographs in the same frame type. You can do a variation of sizes, but I wouldn't have little frames on tables and things all over the place. Okay. I would do a montage of photos. Like if you have a hallway, if you live in a big house or apartment, if you have a hallway where people can come in, almost kind of create like a gallery feel with the montage of photos. And I would say that if you have a wall that's like maybe, you know, an 8-foot wall in height and 10 feet in length, you don't need more than 12 photos. And again, at various sizes and positioning.
Absolutely. Like taking everything off my wall.
Less is more. Remember that less is more. You don't need every picture to debut. And again, you can do pictures by season as well.
Good thought. Thank you.
Thank you for your question. Anyone else? Hi.
How you doing? My name is Jared Ross, a rising senior at Morehouse College. And I just had a question about what kind of weight tips you might have had for people who are necessarily trying to gain weight and maybe trying to just get bigger or stronger instead of necessarily losing weight. You know, I'm not kind of the big guy myself, but, you know, just something for Coach D or a doctor himself.
I'll take it. All right. So that's a very good question because a lot of times everyone's always like, how do I lose weight? How do I lose weight? Some of us are trying to get some muscle on, right? All right. One thing I find that most people don't get protein throughout the day. So like a lot of times we get protein in our last meal of the day because that's their biggest meal. You know, you get your protein, your starch, and maybe too much starch, and then a little bit of vegetables. But I try to remind people to get protein throughout the day. So start your day. If you are eating breakfast, some people are not eating like a solid breakfast. If you are eating breakfast, eggs are a great choice. I don't know if you're going to disagree with me, but what I found is like that you can eat not just the egg white, you can eat the whole egg, it's fine, you know, so eat the eggs. But another great way is, you hear about protein shakes. Make sure you look at them and make sure it's not a lot of sugar in them. You wanna make sure it's not a lot of artificial things, a lot of chemicals in it. But that's a great option for breakfast. It's easy, we're used to waking up drinking some water. So put some water, put 2 scoops, shake it up, and you don't miss the metro to get to class.
Thank you.
No problem.
And weight training, obviously, too, right?
Yeah, and definitely weight training on top of it. You want to make sure if you're trying to build muscle, build lean muscle, you want to do some resistance training. But more important than the weight training is the nutrition, because what we do in the gym is breaking down the muscle, but you got to have the right nutrition to build it back up.
And you mentioned eggs, so are you just talking egg whites, or are the yolks good too?
Definitely the yolks are good. You know, I feel like the studies have wavered back and forth, but lately they've shown that you're not getting higher cholesterol or the bad cholesterol from eating the yolks.
Scott, I wanted to ask you about those frozen diet meals. And so a lot of people eat those, and they eat low-fat treats and sugarless treats, thinking that, okay, I'm really doing something, but are they actually doing more harm?
There's two different things here. So first of all, with a lot of the low-fat and low-carb candies essentially out there, they're not really healthy, and we end up eating a lot more of those, and people often gain weight from that. The other thing you pointed out, though, is about frozen meals, and that's something that I think is very misunderstood. There are some healthy frozen meals, there are some unhealthy frozen meals, but the functional part of the frozen meals is very valuable. Lots of people, myself included, don't have time to go shopping and preparing and cooking and cleaning up their foods every single day, especially after 10, 12 hours at work and commute and all that. So things that make it easier to eat healthy are really valuable. You pointed out a couple of them, a protein shake or something like that, or a protein bar. That's a very valuable snack, for example, during the day. And a frozen meal, as long as it's reasonably healthy, is potentially a very valuable meal to have at dinner if you don't have time, like most of us, to cook that night.
It just seems like they're so high in carbs, and I know I was trying to really monitor my carb count.
Some of them are, but many of them aren't. So here you want to look for quality.
I'm a big fan of the protein meals, and what I use them as, or what I tell people to use them as, is emergency meals. So a lot of times we we fall out of our path of nutrition when things go awry. You know, like, so, oh, I missed here, or, you know, I got in traffic, so I got to this hungry level. And once you're hungry, your mind does not think, oh, I would love some quinoa and some spinach. Right. No, it's like, what's fast, what's fatty, what's high in calories. So those frozen meals can be an easy way. You cook in 3-4 minutes.
Okay, so. Do you guys believe in cheat days?
Oh yeah, of course. with in moderation, definitely in moderation. One thing I do in order to, going back to what you guys were talking about, I pack my full day worth of food to take to the office and just kind of run through that. It makes it easier, baby carrots, cherries, everything that I know that I'll need, and making sure that there's a protein carb mix and balance throughout. Not everybody has time to do that, but it helps. And also pick a cook day. I've found that if I cook 2 to 3 meals on a Sunday and just go back between all three of them throughout the week for lunch and dinner, it makes it a lot easier. But on Saturdays, I will have 2 glasses of wine because, well, that's my cheat day.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, well, we do have 2 questions. Great. Give us your question and your name.
Yes. My name is Princess from Silver Spring, Maryland. My concern is I love working out, especially strength training, as you can see.
Yeah.
My concern is I bulk up really quickly. And as a female, that's not what I want. I would like to tone, but I don't want to get so bulked to look like a man. So I need some advice for that.
Danielle, why don't you take that?
Sure. So a couple of things you could do is lighter weights, longer reps. That's a good way to tone, because if you're trying to build muscle, and correct me if I'm wrong, it's usually heavier weights, shorter sets, and that's how you're really helping the muscle to grow. But if you are trying to just kind of shred a little bit of the layer of fat that we all carry, especially women, it's very difficult to do, longer sets. So if you're, say, doing 8-pound weights, you can do 12 to 15 reps per set, do 3 sets or maybe 4 sets. That's a great way to do it. And there are a lot of great classes that'll also do that for you too, including like a body pump class. It's very much focused around trying to help you tone, not necessarily bulk up. But I will say, I mean, a lot of women say that in class, but you might not be able to bulk as much as you think. But so keep weight training. It's a great way to make sure that you're getting a full body workout.
Okay, great question.
I would also say, make sure you look at your nutrition, because a lot of times, if you know, the more calories you put in, the more you're gonna grow, right? So like, if you're weight training and you're packing on more calories, it will develop into more muscles. But if you're weight training, and maintaining equal energy in versus energy output, then you're not gonna gain weight. You're gonna gain strength, and you're gonna be toned and you know, really. I'm trying to pick the right PC words, like, you know, really define what you want.
Good one.
And also another great thing for that is I feel like yoga is a great counterbalance to that, because the holds are so long, and like in my head I'm like, oh my God, how much more breaths we got. But it's a great way to get toned, because you just have to like really get that muscle endurance.
And Pilates.
Pilates
is good.
Oh God.
All right, thank you.
Hi, my name is Vanita. Is it possible to spot train? Most women hate their hips and their thighs, maybe their booty. So is it possible just to focus on one area of your body to see results?
So I guess that's a great question, because most people, how many people come to me and it's like, you know what, I love this. I just need this gun and this gun. I was like, I don't do plastic surgery. I do physical fitness. So what I would say about spot training is, when it comes to fat loss, no, I'm sorry. It's a lot of your genetics. Like, it's gonna tell you where it wants to take off. A lot of times, women like to carry weight around their hips and some in the midsection. I think that goes back to, like, you know, at the root, we're animals, so you wanna make sure your internal organs are warm all the time. Men like to carry it right in their stomachs. But for muscles, you can do certain exercises to help your thighs, to help everybody.
Sounds good. Thank you for your question. Well, we are going to have to stop it right there, because we want to leave time for folks here in the studio and you at home to get in some exercise. Thanks to all of our guests, our studio audience, and you at home. We hope you learned something today that makes a difference in your life and someone else's. Coach G and Shayla
Well, they're going to take us out. I'm Anqoinette Crosby. Until next time, I'll save you a seat.
All right, let's get it. Everybody can get up on it. With me? You got Taylor, you on the bikes?
All right. You got the woo!
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.